Hi, I'm Bobo, product specialist at ThinkBox Software, and in the following demonstrations we're going to discuss some of the features of Krakatoa SR, the standalone renderer version of Krakatoa. As you probably remember from our first three parts of the SIGGRAPH demo, Krakatoa MX, the 3ds Max version of the renderer, supports the conversion of splines into particles using the PRT here object, and also the control of their density and color using magma flow. You probably asked yourself, why should I define a magma flow each time I want to change the density of my particles? Well, we asked ourselves the same question after recording the video, and we added default set of controls. In this case, there is only one spinner which controls the density fall off along the spline. So if you want to produce a regular fall off without any custom curve controls and or let's say noise functions and so on, you can easily just enter a number like 1, which produces a linear fall off, or a higher or lower number in order to define the density of your hair without using magma. What does this number mean? This is actually an exponent, and in order to understand what it does, it's probably easiest to just hide this here and create a setup that visualizes what the curve really would look like. I'm going to create a spline with a length of 100 units. And I will create a PRT here out of it, and the PRT here will have spacing in the viewport of 0.1 in order to give us enough particles. Let's look in the top view. I'm going to add a Krakatoa channels modifier on top and load a predefined magma flow, which takes the same code as before, the distance divided by the length, but this time puts to the power of an exponent, and subtracting the result from 1, then passing it up, and if the exponent is 0, then we output 1 instead. Otherwise, we get the result up. We convert it to a vector, so only the y coordinate is being changed. The x and z remain 0, and then we add to the original position, which is along the spline, the result that we calculated from the function. We also multiply it by 20 in order to scale it to make the y-axis a little bit more visible. And that goes out to the position channel. If I enable the auto, and the exponent was actually exposed to the command panel, so we can see the result, you'll see that currently the line is at 20 units along y. That means the value was actually 1 multiplied by 20. If we switch to 1, we get the linear fall off. This is the exponential function using an exponent of 1. If we go with higher numbers or spin the spinner, the curvature will change, and you'll notice that the fall off of the density will basically describe a curve where the hair, if you imagine that the left side is the root and this is the tip, the density will be approximately 1 for most of the length of the hair, and then it will fall off only at the tip. If we go with values below 1, we're going to get the opposite. We'll get a very thick curve only at the very root, and then the rest will be more needle-like and very, very thin. So with a value of about 0.1, we're going to get a very, very thin hair. Let's delete this setup and take a look again at the original setup. We're going to disable the magma flow that is currently on the hair, and will render with the density fall off of 0, just to get an idea how that number is changing the hair. If we render now, we'll get the result that we got in the very, very first test, in the first part of our demonstration, where we didn't have any density fall off and the hair had the same thickness along the spline. If we change the value to 1, we're going to get the linear fall off, so the hair will be thinning out from root to tip. If we go with an even higher number, like 5, the here will be mostly the same thickness, except for the tips, which will be slightly rounded off. And if we go with value of 0.1, we'll produce very thin hair. What does this have to do with Krakatoa Standalone? Well, Krakatoa Standalone actually supports export and import of splines. So the renderer itself is going to perform the same operation as the PRT here does inside of Krakatoa MX. That means that we can pass a very small file with the description of the actual hair splines produced by any 3D application, and then the particles, the 3.2 million particles, will be generated on the fly. But the current version of Krakatoa SR doesn't support magma flow yet, so it wouldn't be possible to actually provide a density fall-off the same way we did in Krakatoa MX. But the Krakatoa SR supports the density fall-off parameter of the PRT here, so at export time, this parameter will be written out, and the hair generated inside of Krakatoa SR is going to match the hair generated by Krakatoa MX. Let's set the value to 1 again, and open Krakatoa and export the file, the current scene, to a Krakatoa SR scene description. In order to do this, we have to make sure that we have a valid render output file name specified. If we explore the path, you see that this is the location, the path exists, but there is currently nothing in it. And if I take a look at the preferences, you also notice that we have Krakatoa SR export preferences and the opening of the Python scene after export was enabled, and the notepad exe is going to be used, and the running of the scene with Python 2.7 was also specified. So after we hit the export frame, not only will we be rendering the data out, that means saving the splines and creating the definition of the file, but the file will also be opened and rendered. Let's hit the export frame button. Here is the file that was generated. This is the scene description in Python language. And this is a command window which actually had the renderer running the scene and producing frame 0. If we take a look at the output path now, we're going to find a couple of files and folders there. The .exr file is the actual render result that was produced. The scene folder contains the Python Krakatoa file. This is the scene description that we saw in Notepad. And this is the curves file, which is only 3 megabytes in size and contains all the splines that the 3ds Max here and fur generated. The batch file triggers the rendering using Krakatoa SR renderer, which is a module inside of Python. So if we take a look at the batch file, we call Python and pass the path to Krakatoa in it, to the Krakatoa scene. If we take a look at the scene description, which is the notepad file, you'll notice that in addition to a header which describes who and when exported that file, we are importing Krakatoa SR. This is the module that deals with the communication between the scene and the renderer. We take render interface out of the Krakatoa SR module and then set render properties, which define all the globals and the settings like lighting and save modes and the different filters and so on. We have the description of the output, which frame we are rendering, at what resolution, what is the output, and what is the current projection, that's the camera with the field of view and potentially the shutter. We have the global overrides, so I can set the colors. Currently they are remarked because they were off originally here, but if you want to enable, for example, white color override there, it's very easy to just remove the remark from here and enable the override. Then we have the transformation into world space, and then the world begins, where we define in Renderman style the attributes of the different entities that we have in the scene, which are in this case the lights. This is the shading definition before we actually define the attributes of the curve loader. It loads that curves file and uses the world spacing of 0.1 that we had in the PRT here, and the density falloff, which is currently 1.0. When it hits world end, it triggers the renderer, and then we print out the time that it took to render. Let's not save this, and let's go back and take a look at the output that was generated. If I right click the export button, there is a new option now. If you render a frame and the frame exists on disk, we are going to get the option to look at that frame in a virtual frame buffer, in an external viewer, in the RAM player, or if it's a sequence, an animation of many frames, you can load the whole animation in RAM player. Let's load the single frame because we have only one anyway. And this goes into the channel A, and this is the result of the rendering. Now let's switch Krakatoa MX to render the same frame. It will retrieve the particles and render with the same falloff of 1. And then we'll go to channel B in the RAM player, and we'll load the last rendering. Now we have A and B active, and if I move the divider between the two frames, you won't see any difference because they are completely identical. That means Krakatoa SR, based on a file containing only spline definitions and the description of the scene, produced exactly, pixel perfect, the same image as Krakatoa MX based on the same data. In the next part of this demonstration, we're going to look at the ability of Krakatoa SR to render baked particles containing magma flow information, materials, deformations, and so on, as well as the export of matte objects to define the holdouts within the standalone renderer.